Can you hear me like that? The cable is a bit in the way. Yes, so the title is split into the why and the how. So first I will focus on the why, then on the how, and also about campaigns and the difference about campaigns and other styles of activism. But what do people do if they have talks? They are greeting friends and families, but I will instead greet the lawyer of the hunters in Austria, because 3 years ago our chairperson, Baluch, had a talk at this space, at this time, at this conference, and this lawyer, those hunters, used it to sue our organization and to use it to criminalize us and to say how radical we are. So Mr. Lawyer, if you are watching now, hello, I hope you find out how we will put you out of business. Yeah, and disclaimer kind of, so I figured out that in Britain, people use hunting for a very specific kind of hunting, so they use it for hunting with dogs, with packs of hounds, but I think on the continent of Europe and in Austria and Germany, we use hunting more as an umbrella term. So if I talk about hunting, I mean everything where people are chasing and killing wild animals and not just hunting with hounds. And I have to start with a confession also. I was wrong, because in the abstract I was saying there are no talks about hunting and it's not an important issue anymore. But actually at this conference there are 3 talks about hunting. So this is the most since I'm doing those conferences. One is on Friday about the hunting myths, the facts. And the other one is about actually doing hunt saps. So I will very minorly focus on these things because you see them in these talks. Yeah, and firstly, I want to talk a bit about our theory of change. I mean, when I started, it was just doing activism, doing this and that, but then effective altruism came, and a lot of things changed for me. I suddenly cared about numbers, I cared about effectiveness, things like animal charity evaluators erased, and the styles of campaigns, I think, changed a bit. And if I look at the animal rights movement, especially at the big organizations, they're focusing mostly on farmed animals. And of course, this is a good thing because higher numbers and great effect. But I think a few topics have been neglected. And one of these topics is hunting. And if I talk about hunting about this at this other conference, as people are looking at me, what, you're doing hunting campaigns? Why aren't you doing chicken campaigns? So this is also a bit of a defense where we still should do hunting campaigns and not leave them out completely. And I think when doing political work, it's not only about the numbers. It's really a political thing. It's about giving the animals more importance in society. And it's a step-by-step process, and it's not always about the numbers. And this is our theory of change, so to say. Here on the graph, you see the things society has agreed we don't want anymore, like animal torture for fun, for example, things like bullfighting. Most people just detest it. Or in countries like Austria, things like dogfighting. It's completely illegal, and if you want to do it, it's very hard to do, very hard to keep up. And on the other hand, you have vegetarianism and veganism. It's still very hard, and society is actually pulling you down. And what we as an organization actually want to do is make the norm of society the veganism, the animal liberation. So it's the easiest thing to do to live as an animal rights person and to make it very hard to actually exploit animals. And if you're following this path, you can't always do the campaigns and the animals with the highest numbers, because you have done your chicken campaigns, and if you want to move further in that field, it just becomes quite difficult. So you have to move on to a different thing like hunting. And it's also not only about the behavior, it's about the ideology, that is speciesism. And I think it's very important to fight speciesism in order to win this fight and to change this curve. Yeah, and if I look at the opposition, it looks like a phalanx. I see all the spears, the shields, it looks impenetrable. It's very hard to attack, so to say, this opponent. And it's then important to look for a weak spot. Which kind of campaign I can do now, what's winnable, what's also mattering for the animals, and what's the political gain, and also what is shocking the public, what is really appalling the public. So if we look on public opinions about hunting, we can ask people, do we want a ban on hunting? And actually, only 24% of people say they favor a complete hunting ban. a lot of people, they don't really know where to position themselves. So if you would do a campaign now against hunting on its all, it would be very difficult because you have only one quarter of society on your side. And you would do your things and maybe do it for some times, but I think you wouldn't actually gain things, and then you lose motivation, you lose interest, and then you just stop. But if you look at certain aspects of hunting, like are you in favor of a ban of releasing game birds, you suddenly have a big majority. You have 71%, and this would be also a majority in parliament. This would be a majority to choose to change a constitutional law in parliament, so a very huge majority. So I will argue for finding things that you have those majorities and then making campaigns to win step by step by step. And actually, this figure is really low. So there was an US survey about are you in favor of a ban of slaughterhouses, and 49% said yes. And here we have only the half. So this is really a low number. This also shows how much work we still have to do. And another argument maybe for hunting campaigns is, so we are the pro-animal people, we are the vegans. We spend a lot of our lives for that, it's our passion, we go to conferences like that, we go to veg fests and everything. We have those big groups. But then I asked myself the question, every political game has players on both sides of the field. And I asked myself, who are actually the anti-vegans? And I don't think the meat eaters are actually the anti-vegans, because there is no Carnism Vienna group. I had to found it myself. But there are those big vegan groups. And I looked and looked, and then I found the hunting groups. They're very big hunting groups. And for me, they're kind of similar to the vegan groups. They're sharing recipes and events and organizing shitstorms, just like we vegans do. So this is also why we should focus on them, because I think speciesism is even stronger in hunters than normal meat-eating people. Because if you ask meat-eating people, if is meat-eating an essential part of your identity, I think in a discussion they would say yes, but out of the blue, I don't think they would say so. But for hunters, it's really a passion. They spend a lot of money on it. It's part of their lifetime. If you look at the Facebook profiles of hunters, it's almost with vegans. They have the profile with hunting and all the photos of hunting. So it's really a huge part of their identity. Okay, this was messed up, kind of. And this, and I also think it's a very speciesist ideology. And we all know the things that we say, meat to animal corpses, or slaughtering to killing, which is of course a euphemism, and is making it look not as bad as it is. But I think hunters are turning it up to 11 when it comes to this. They're doing this even worse. So I chose the German terms because I'm more familiar with them, but I will try to translate them. Some are not really translatable. For example, an animal becomes ein Stück Wild, just a piece of game. So you have a living, breathing, feeling animal, and the hunter is just referring to it as a piece. Then the blood of the animal is called Schweiß, like just sweat. And killing is not killing, it's just to bag those animals. And what's not on the list, but what hunters doing after the hunt, they are just piling up all those animals on a huge pile, like, and they're bringing them together and killing those animals. They also refer to them, just bringing those animals to the pile, just they would bring car parts to a racing track when they are talking about living, feeling creatures. Also, disemboweling these people is just breaking them up, and an animal that is shot and not dead is just sick instead of really injured. So it's a very speciesist ideology that's making it seem very harmless to kill animals. And it also makes sense, because meat eating is difficult enough, but you're not killing them yourself. You just find the packed meat and eat it. But in order to look into the eyes of an animal, have the gun and shoot them directly, I think speciesism has even to be stronger in you. This is also a picture, as Carolina said in her talk, an important part of discrimination is not talking about the subjects as individuals, but as parts. And hunters have also, for all parts of the animal, different names than normal, I'd say, society. And maybe a lesser known fact, the German and Austrian hunting law, they are based on the Reichsjagdgesetz of the German Nazis. So they did that law, and it was very little changed And so the basis of the German and Austrian hunting law still have the basis in that. And what comes with that kind of law is also a very social Darwinist ideology and agenda to say there are those individuals, and some are more important and some are better than the others. And in order to improve things, we have to sort out the weak ones. And this is also a big part of hunting ideology. They say, if this stag doesn't have nice antlers, we have to remove them. They're just harmful to the gene pool. And of course, this has very little basis in biology. It's just an ideology. And hunters are also, of course, saying that hunting is necessary and it's producing a lot of food. But here's a chart, actually, how little wild animals are there on the most mass is actually humans and livestock. And also the consumption of game meat, so venison, the meat of hunted animals in Austria, is only 1 kilogram, whereas other meat is 65 kilogram per person and year. So it's contributing very little to actually, yeah, the nutrition of humans. And I will ask you a question, if we would just eat hunted animals, so all the lions and the birds, zebras, how long would it take us to just kill off all the wild animals, all the vertebrates? Any guesses? How many days will it take us? 1 day? 5 hours? 20 days? Anyone else? Yeah, so a colleague of mine calculated it. It's actually 18 days. So if you would just eat wild animals and keep our meat consumption up, every vertebrate would be gone in 18 days. So meat can't be really the reason, Laura, why hunters are hunting. It's actually about the fun they're having. And if you look at it, it's really crazy what they're doing. So if I go to a hunt, I'm really traumatized by what I'm seeing. I mean, they are hurting those animals, they are killing those animals. But hunters, they're taking great steps to get there. They're traveling for hours. They're paying a lot of money. They're paying thousands and thousands of euros. They're even going to Africa just to hunt. So, and this is also the difference, for example, with slaughterhouse workers. Of course, they also kill animals, but they get paid for it very little. They are exploited by that system, and they get traumatized by that. But hunters are actively seeking this behavior. The German philosopher Richard David Brecht also said, hunting is like taking a sledgehammer, going to a slaughterhouse, then getting a lot of money and saying, I'll pay you 100 euros, and I want to hit some cows with that hammer. So it's a very, they're making it also more painful for the animals than necessary. And the baseline of the German and Austrian animal welfare law is also, animal cruelty is unnecessary harm. But what's the necessity here of hunting? And also a very interesting side fact, in the Austrian Animal Welfare Act, hunting is excluded. Because if it would be included, I think almost all practices of hunting would be illegal. And it's very important to figure out that it's complete difference if you're doing individual outreach or campaigning. So, of course, if you're on the street doing your cubes, doing your whatever, you want to convince the individual person. And a very specific set of rules apply there. But with hunting, you can't really convince them individually because it's so deeply ingrained in them. So it's not about changing them themselves, but changing the society around them. So convincing the 97% that are not hunting, that those 3% shouldn't do hunting anymore. And so different rules apply. So you can be more confrontative. You don't have to be so nice and everything because it's not about convincing them individually. And also I think we have to do it ourselves. For meat eating, there will arise a lot of alternatives like Beyond Meat, Impossible Meat, then maybe at some point clean meat, also for other kind of things. But I think with hunting, I don't clearly see that kind of technical alternatives. And for example, with horse carriages, it was also the car that replaced the most horse carriages in the beginning 20th century without really an animal welfare or the animal rights campaigns. Just the technology almost abolished those horse-drawn carriages. But I think with, maybe it can be the same with meat, but I don't think it can be done with hunting, and this is why we have to do it ourselves. Of course, there is this clay shooting, but I don't think it's really a replacement. And of course, there are those VR glasses the virtual reality glasses or computer games, but all of this already exists and it didn't make hunting less attractive. So I don't think we have a technical solution here. We actually have to do an old style hard-hitting campaign. Another reason is we should do it ourselves. So if we neglect the topic of hunting, who will then deal with it? We leave it basically to the hunters and they will approach the politicians and basically then the hunting laws are written by hunters then. Of course, there are conservation groups, wildlife groups, but I don't think they have that very strong rights argument and not that passion and they are not as strategic, I think. And this is why I think we should do it, because we pack the punch, we have the passion. This is why we also should make this our topic. And of course, if I ban, for example, Austria banned fur farms, now we have the issue that all the fur is imported. But with hunting, if it's banned, you can't really import it. You can only export the hunters. You can then go to Africa, but you can't import the lion to Austria and hunt the lion there. And you can't also export the hunting. So once we have, for example, if I don't eat meat, maybe it's exported to another country and it's still eaten, but with hunting, you can't import it, you can't export it. It's very locally specific. So if it's banned in this country, there will be less suffering in this country and it's not so easy to make up for that with exports and imports. And of course, winning is fun. If you want to be active for a longer time, you need your wins. And this is what's actually possible with hunting campaigns. You can have your goals and you can win and you make the law better and you can make the situation better in the amount of time where you are active. And if people are asking me about hunting campaigns, just maybe saying, why are you focusing on this? I mean, there are factory farms, animals have very little space, they are cramped, so horrible conditions, and hunting wild animals, they are so happy, then one shot and it's over. This is the imagination, this is the public image of hunting, and maybe even some activists have that. But the reality is, there is factory farming actually in hunting. There are those facilities where pheasants, partridges, so wild birds are bred, then they are set out, then they are shot in masses, so in really big amounts. So I think there are things like, I don't know, bullfighting and circuses that are very shocking to the public, but very little numbers, and it's quite easy to ban them. And then there's, of course, factory farming, which is more systematic, maybe harder to ban, but affects a lot of animals. But this is kind of a combination of both. It's shocking for the public and it affects quite a large amount of animals. And what also shocks a lot of people is they are not even eaten. So even if you do agree that we should eat animals, which we of course shouldn't, but even if you do agree, people are against this. It's really shocking to them. And so it's the worst of two worlds. Here you see boxes where those pheasants are crammed in before they will set them out to shoot them for fun. And putting things in perspective, people telling me, why are you focusing on hunting so little animals? And Marek from Obras from the Czech Republic said a few years ago, okay, I do fur campaigns because there are actually more mink in the EU than there are cows. And I did the math for pheasants and partridges. And in the UK, in the United Kingdom alone, there are more pheasants and partridges than cows in the entire European Union. And of course, if we would ban cow farming altogether, it would be a revolution. I mean, it's hard to imagine Europe without cow farming if you talk about the numbers. But if you would just ban bird shooting and breeding them in the UK, it would affect more animals, actually. And also with animal liberation and farmed animals, it's hard to see a clear path. Of course, we know kind of the way where I want to go. Tobias Lennart calls it the vegan world. I would call it more of a liberated world where human and non-human animals can be free, but it's very hard to figure out a way where we will get to now, to this utopia. But with hunting, the interesting thing is you have a lot of countries and a lot of different laws and very different stages. So you have countries where almost everything is possible, like a few hundred years ago, you can almost do anything and everything with these animals. And then there are countries where hunting is very limited and almost banned. You, of course, have UK, the infamous fox hunting with hounds, which is officially banned. They're still doing it. Then Austria, before our campaigns, you had canned hunting, you had game farms, but you didn't have fox hunting. then Germany, at least as far as I know, the cat hunting is not as usual than in Austria. And then there's one region of Germany that had, until this or last year, even better law. It wasn't even called hunting law anymore. It was called a wildlife management law. So very little species were allowed to hunt. It was illegal to shoot cats. It was illegal to hunt with traps. So it was a very big step forward. Then we have the Netherlands, where there's no fox hunting or shooting at all. And then there are regions of Austria. So the city of Vienna is the second biggest landowner in Austria. And the property of the city of Vienna, they're only hunting ungulates, so animals like wild boar and stags, because at least they are claiming they are damaging the forests. But all birds are not shot. They are not shooting foxes, no small predators. So another step. And then finally we have the region, the Swiss region of Geneva. There was a grassroots campaign in the 70s done by two people, and it was a referendum. Do you want to ban hunting? And those two people actually won the referendum, and hunting was completely banned, at least almost. So there is no private hunting. There used to be hundreds of private hunters. They did driven hunts. They did the worst things you can imagine. But now it's a public thing. There is one wildlife regulator, and he's responsible for all of those animals. And if there are damages to forests or to gardens or to orchards, the government will reimburse those farmers and will reimburse those owners of forests. And in very rare circumstances, single wild boar are killed by rangers, not by private people. Of course, this is not perfect, and you could even move one step upwards if you would do some kind of population control. But it's very hard to bring it through because it would be some kind of animal testing, and it's easy for the hunters to say, oh, this is so artificial, and this is using hormones. But it would be possible. So we actually have a country where hunting is almost illegal. And of course, it's also possible to just resettle those animals. So if a wild boar enters a city, you don't have to kill them. You just catch them alive and set them out somewhere else. And I think this is very important because this is a completely different way of dealing with animals. If you just treat them as objects to have fun, and the hunters in the UK are calling it a sport, a blood sport, or if you're doing almost anything to not kill those animals and to just live together with those animals. I think it's a very different way to approach animals, and it's very important to embrace this. Yeah, talking about tactics, handsabbing is quite popular. What we almost changed, at least as an organization, was monitoring the hands. Of course, handsabbing is illegal. It's still, I think, legitimate, but it is illegal, and if you want to keep it on for a long time, it gets very hard because you face a lot of repression. But if you are monitoring those hunts, so you go to the hunts and film them, you have almost the same effects, but you can be legal. You are on the path, you're filming them. A lot of hunts, they will just stop, because if they are filmed, they will stop hunting. So it almost has the same effect, but if they are calling the police can't remove you. And you can always say they are the ones who are doing the cruelty and we are just legal. Of course, as grassroots activists, it's maybe a bit different, but as a big organization, this was our way to go. Yeah, monitoring without sabbing versus sabbing. And with sabbing alone, I have the feeling, do you use it as a tactic, so as a part of a bigger strategy, or is sabbing your strategy on its own? So, and I think of it, of hunting or animal exploitation, as a tree. And I think if you're hunt sabbing, you're just cutting off those small branches at the end for one hunting season, but next season they will regrow, and you will have to be there and cut them off again. But they will just regrow because you're not going to the stem and not going to the roots. But if you do use hunt sabbing as a tactic, you can first cut off the tiny branches, then the smaller branches, and then finally get to the stem and to the root. So for us, or for me, it's a tactic but not a strategy, and we use it in a bigger part of other actions in order to ban those things we are sabbing completely, because otherwise it will be an endless story. Yeah, this is the difference between really campaigning or just doing isolated activism. Then this is of course a controversial topic, but I think you should protect your identity when hunting, because they will strike back, they will sue you, they will charge you. And the classic way to do it is, of course, the balaclava, but this will also help them to criminalize you, and they can say, okay, they are terrorists. And if you compare this guy and this guy, it's a bit of a difference. But I think this is already an example where it doesn't look that bad, or you can wear a white scarf and something like that, or you can just hold the camera in front of your face. So protect your identity, but be aware that hunters will use those pictures to criminalize you. And if you really want to change public opinion, public image is important. Of course, if you're a grassroots group just doing this and just caring about the action, it's not of that big importance. Yeah, then actually, how to put this together, how to actually campaign. So a very important thing is picking your target. So it has to be big enough that it matters, but if it's too big, you just can't win and you, I don't know, you burn out and then you stop and then you don't win anything at all. Yeah, those are beautiful vegan sausages, and the hunters accuse us of using the salami tactic. So we're chopping off one piece, then one piece, one piece, one piece, one piece, and then we will ban all hunting. And this is exactly what we want to do. And we picked game farming, so breeding birds for shooting, and enclosure hunting, so fencing off the forest and then shooting the animals there, and the animals can't really escape. It's like making an arena out of a forest. This is before you actually start the campaign, and this is very important and almost the hardest part, really. Then investigate those facilities. I mean, we didn't even know what canned hunting was. I didn't know it before that campaign. But after investigating, you get an expert yourself. Get your facts straight, get your experts, do the press conferences, and then if you have all the facts together, go public. So, and you start off very softly, just inform the public with very nice kind of actions. This is almost like vegan outreach, but with hunting. It can also be done in a lot of other ways. But then this alone isn't enough. And then you will reach maybe the critical mass, you will reach 70% of approval. And then you think in a democracy, okay, if 70% of people agree with me, it will be banned. But this is where it just starts, because our system is very bad in turning majorities into actual policies. And this is, yeah, why we have to do it. We have to get political, say this politician, it's their fault that it's not banned, protest directly in front of their officers and say it's their fault that this is not banned. And don't stop with the hunters, go on to the political level. And then, okay, you talk to the politicians, you send them letters, and they just say no. And is it over now? Then you have just to go one step further, get confronted. If they have a press conference, confront them. Describe them, describe them, describe them. The topic shouldn't go away, because otherwise it will just die down. If they will still don't act, you just have to turn up one step more and occupy the office and just say, we are not leaving until you will change this policy. So in our campaign, we focused on four regions of Austria. In two regions, we have had to do the occupations, but they were conservative regions. In this region, it's social democrat governed, we have had stopped with the disruptions. So disruptions were enough in order to change the law. And in Vienna, which is green and social democrats, it stopped with the informing the public. This was enough. So it really depends. But I think it's good to have all these steps in your mind, because it gives you confidence and it tells you, okay, if they won't change it, we have something up our sleeves, we can escalate this and we can go on and on and on, and it will just not stop. And then getting the law, I think there are few things that are nicer than seeing actually politicians voting for the law that you have achieved. And then you would think you have won, but you haven't won. You have to enforce the law. This is a cartoon of a very famous hunter in Austria being in prison, but he wasn't in prison for hunting, but for corruption. So having the law alone is not enough. In the UK, it is illegal to do fox hunts, but it's legal to trail hunt. So they are saying they're just laying a trail, and then accidentally, the hounds will attack the foxes. So actually, the numbers didn't really go down. So you have to enforce the law, or maybe even make a better law, because the law you have at the moment isn't working. And what the animal exploiters also can, of course, do is appeal the law and bring it to the constitutional court, because they are saying the constitution is allowing me to use animals. This contradicts the constitution, this law, and then maybe your constitutional court will bring it down, this law, and you will have to start over again. So it's not done with that phase. Maybe it just starts and it takes some more years. But then you finally win. Yeah, and then it's rest, recovering from that campaign, and repeating, getting to the next topic, and getting further to animal liberation. Yeah, and Tobias Lennart said make compassion easier. I say make exploitation harder. So it should be very difficult for people to hunt. It shouldn't be in your country. They should have to leave the country. It should be very expensive. It shouldn't be fun. It shouldn't be something that is big in society. So make it very unattractive. It's really a structural thing. And a thing that got got popular in the last year were corporate campaigns. For example, who doesn't know the campaigns against McDonald's, or I don't know, that they shouldn't use cage eggs. And some very smart campaigners in the United Kingdom are now using those tactics, the corporate campaigns, with huntings, because they have found out, okay, the legal way doesn't just work, but who owns the land where those animals are shot? Actually, big water companies. And they now have picked one water company, Yorkshire Waters, and they're doing a corporate campaign against this company until they will ban grouse shooting on their lands. So we in Austria haven't tried out, but you could try it out. It's a very interesting tactic. So if you want to get involved in this kind of campaigns, I think there are a few questions you can ask yourselves. First, what are actually the laws against hunt sabbing? In Austria, it's not actually illegal to sap the hunt, but just to be in the area where people are hunting. But if you're just standing there and they don't like it and they stop, it's not hunt sabbing by law. I know that in Poland it's almost completely legal, and in the UK that a lot of land is privately owned, so it's very hard without trespassing. So this matters. And is it a regional or national affair? So a lot of countries have federal hunting laws, like they have federal animal welfare laws, but Austria has 9 hunting laws. And so actually to ban some kind of hunting, you have to do 9 campaigns. So if you have a federal hunting law, it's a lot easier. So if you have one of those laws, yeah, it's easier and you should even do it more. And what kind of hunting system is there? In Austria, it's that way, it's bound to the property. So if you own the land, you can rent the hunting. It's bound to the land. So what hunters will do, they will build a lot of hunting towers, they will feed a lot, and they will try to feed the animals so that they are on their hunting grounds, that they can shoot them. So this is the worst hunting system, because it encourages feeding, it encourages canned hunting, and all those bad things. In some countries, it's a license system. So you just buy a license to shoot on animals, and it's not that bound with the property anymore, and the hunters aren't as powerful anymore on those lands. Then how many hunters are there in your country? For example, Austria has a lot of hunters. 3% of our population hunt. In a lot of countries, it's only 1%. Then how far are you in the path of victory chart? Are you in the UK where it's very bad? Or are you in a country where it's almost done? Look at the laws and think, where is it? Where are we and where can we start? What are the things that we could approach? And then, are there any organizations already working on it? And then do your research. Are there hunting associations? Which politicians support hunting? Which parties support hunting? Which events are around hunting where you can protest? And how big is their political influence? The political influence of hunters in Austria is extremely big. So there's that hunting ball, and a network scientist found out that this is actually the most influential event in the entire country. So there is no events where more jobs and more relations are distributed than at this hunting ball. So if you attack hunting in a country like this, it's really also attacking the powerful. Then it might be also about redrawing line, defining that some animals are not ours to kill. For example, foxes in countries like Luxembourg or the Netherlands, which is also a great thing to do. And it's, of course, rewriting history. People have hunted for such a long time, and also there's those forms of feudal hunting like they do in the UK. They also did this for hundreds and hundreds of years. And also the game bird shooting and canned hunting they did in Austria, they also did for hundreds and hundreds of years. And then there was just one small crazy group of people who said, okay, we want to ban it, and in 3-4 years, we banned it. And it's just amazing and so motivating to see that we actually as a movement can ban things that were there for hundreds and hundreds of years, and that what we do is not a numbers game, but actually matters and is actually rewriting history. Yeah, thanks.